So, in my next section, I like to discuss a few things that could be related to brute force calibration. So our last section was on calibration, but maybe it's just a general section on some nice tools for working with computers and also doing some cloud computing. Yeah. So maybe as a motivation, when we talked about calibration, then one remark was here that we could just use brute force. So just using more compute power to solve the numerical problems. So, and compute power nowadays is not so expensive, yeah. So maybe we could just do a brute force Monte Carlo calibration of a problem of a model. So brute force Monte Carlo calibration requires compute power. So I like to have a small session on some software development tools. And then maybe show you a little bit how you can use the cloud to perform calculations. Well, the section is independent, yeah, and maybe also useful if you work on some project, yeah, on your thesis or whatever, and try to make your program run faster or independent of your computer. Let's start with a small review of some tools. I'm sure that most of you already know all these tools, so this is maybe just for reference here, and I will try to go through this more quickly. So first of all, we use Git as a version control system, yeah, so to keep track of changes that we do, especially if we work in a group of people, yeah. So but it's also nice to keep everything nicely together and to download a whole project by just a single command, yeah. So if you have a directory, yeah, that contains all your project files, most operating systems nowadays have Git already installed, and you can just issue Git clone repository and he will download the full directory with all the files. So that's also a nice way of just downloading stuff, yeah, instead of downloading a zip, a tar or whatever, unpacking it and stuff like that. And you can easily update the directory using Git pull. So that's also nice if, for example, you work on a machine and you would like to have the same stuff on the other machine, you just issue Git pull and the other machine is pulling the stuff. So that's also useful if you work with remote machines to have your stuff organized in a Git repository. In the lecture, we already have a few repositories here. The library can be found in this repository. I also have a repository on GPU, on the GPU extension, which we might explore in one of the next session. And what I would also mention is here this experiments repository, which actually references this library. So it has the library as a dependency, but also comes with some other useful stuff, and we can use it as a starting point. Well, speaking of dependency, yeah, one very nice tool here is Maven. An alternative would be Cradle. And so what's nice with the Maven is if you have a project that needs some tools from a library, yeah, or from another project, then well, the former traditional former the Yeah, the old style way. Yeah, the old style was to download the library, download the stuff you need from the internet, unpack it, put the library in some folder, some lib folder, then update some path or class path variable to point to this and check that your project can use it. And this is, well, among other tasks, yeah, one of the tasks that is done by Maven. So in the Maven, so for Maven, you configure all your dependencies and all the properties of the project in a file, this pom.xml, which describes your project and also the dependencies in the sense what libraries you need. Yeah. So for example, you could say that you need here the Commons Math, a mathematical functions library, or here the FinMatLib, and this is stated in this pom.xml. So we can, for example, have a look at such a pom. So the project object model, that's the name. Yeah. So here, for example, the library states, yeah, also some developers, and it. Where is the dependency section? I have to look. So here, for example, let's have a look here. So that's the POM of the FinMatLib, and it states here somewhat the dependencies. Yeah. So that means if you like to run something from this library, Maven will take care to download this stuff from the internet, put it in the right place, and set the class path for Java such that Java finds this stuff. Yeah. So there's a lot of stuff going on behind the scenes. Of course, Maven can do also other stuff like package your project into a jar, deploy your project, so upload your project to some place, to the Maven repository, such that others can find it, and so on. We can also look at this POM here of the experiments project. That one is a bit smaller. Yeah, it also specifies which Java version you like to use. Yeah, Java 11. For the project, and specifies here some dependencies. So here you also have a dependency section. You can also have Maven plugins. So you can specify here some plugins for Maven. I will come to this in the next session, the next section. So one nice plugin is, for example, the Maven exec plugin, which allows you to run a main method directly from the command line. So Maven will take care of setting all the parameters you need, like the class path and so on. So you can call here this command, Maven clean, cleans up the project, so it deletes all the files that have been compiled in the previous run, then install, recompiles your project and installs your project in the Maven repository. Skip test is that I don't like to execute tests here. And then comes the call to the plugin. And then I say, okay, use the Maven exec plugin running a Java program, and you specify the main class. So you can run this immediately from the command line. So maybe we try this here. Remember here, this here is the class name of the small experiments we did to check the numerical error of the zero Cooper bond under different measures. Yeah? So I would like to run this program here. So I would like to run this main. Yeah? So there were different experiments here. You maybe remember this. Okay, so let's run this. Okay, so that's just the line we had on the slide. So now he's starting Maven. Yeah, Maven is compiling my project. If he would have to download something from the internet, he would also download that from the internet. Okay, then you see several plugins at work. And now comes the exec plugin and run the application. So I'm directly running this from a command line. So that was the zero bond error when we used the control variant. You maybe remember that. That was the forward rate error, you know, on our model. And now he's running this. And you also see I have some graphical output. Okay, so let's stop that. So that's that's a nice plugin, yeah. So you can also try other stuff. Another nice plugin for Maven is JShell, the JShell plugin. Well, JShell has nothing to do with Maven. JShell is a Java shell, a REPL, so that you can enter some Java code and immediately calculate it. In connection with Maven, the nice thing is that you can run this JShell from a Maven project and he immediately knows all the dependencies. So let me show that to you here in the same project. So now I'm running Maven JShell run from this project. So he will start Maven. Maven will compile my project if he has to compile it. Yeah. So if you do Maven clean install, then he will recompile it. And he will start this JShell. And the nice thing is that now I have all the classes that are actually references that are in this project, and all the classes from dependencies that are referenced by this project, I all have them now here. So I can, for example, create a time discretization by writing here the name of the time discretization class. Yeah. Initial value, 10 time points, 10 time step size. And you will create this object. Yeah, and you can print this. This object. Okay, so that's a nice tool if you like to do some small calculations, some small experiments. Yeah, so you can also just do some calculation here. It's like a small calculator, that understands Java, but also understands here classes from libraries that are part of this project. That's a part that is done by Maven. And I have some more experiments here on a web page. So if you like to explore this. Yeah, so there are many such experiments. Okay, so maybe I will add some more in the future. Yeah, but you can also have a look here at some algorithmic differentiation. And you find here the code that you just have to paste into the shell. So maybe I can do that here for that one. Yeah. So you just copy this. You can also just click here on copy to clipboard, and you paste this into the shell. And he will do some calculation. Here you will see some plot of sampling uniform random numbers with different method, uniform and normal distributed random numbers. Okay, so that's the JShell, which is useful. Um, Another thing which I would like to mention is logging. Yeah. So in my experiments here with you, I often print stuff to the console using system.out.print line. Well, that's a bit ugly because then it's always printed to the console and you maybe have to create some if statement if there should be a printout or not. A good style is to have a logger. So a logger is just a class, yeah, which you can create, for example, here with this line. There are different logging frameworks. So this here is the Java util logging framework or Joule. So this is built in. It is not very powerful, but the nice thing is it is built in. So it comes with every Java framework. And so you can get this logger and then you can check for a log level. And then if a certain log level is set, you can log some message. And now the user can decide when he starts your program, whether he likes to see the log message or not. So you can always have this in your program like a printout, but the user can switch on messages or not. So for example, we viewed the Leben-Berg-Marquardt algorithm, and the Leben-Berg-Marquardt algorithm also has here in this iteration where he calculates the So here in this iteration where he is optimizing the point, the Leben-Berg-Marquardt algorithm also has here some logging message. So it checks for log level fine, and then it prints some message. And maybe we can try that. Yeah. So let me exit here the J shell. Maybe clear the screen. And let me run now here a program. Yeah, so maybe not that one, the one from the session where we did the calibration. So I would like to run this program. Okay, so let's also run it using Maven exec. So I would like to run this. And this performs the calibration of our interest rate model, yeah, using the Leben-Berg-Marquardt algorithm. So you maybe remember this from the last session. So you see he is using here calibration to swaptions using the normal model. But we don't see what actually the solver, the optimizer, is doing right now. Yeah? So we don't see this. So now let's run this again using a configuration where the logger is switched on, or actually it's always on, but switched to a finer logging level. So you do this by specifying a file that has the properties of the logger. So where's that? So you have this logging.properties file, and here you can specify that the logger should use the log level fine and write that to the console. You can also write it to some TCP IP port, yeah, where then some program collects this. So I have to specify this. So there's a parameter minus D. So let's look that up. So you have to specify Java util logging config file. So Java util config file equals your logging properties file. So, and if you specify this parameter, he will now take the configuration of the logger from that file. And hopefully, if I did everything right, we will see now the output of the Leben-Berg-Marquardt algorithm. Yeah. So you see there is some output here, iteration one, iteration two, and we see here the values of the lambdas. Okay, there was some exception here because he also tried to send the log file to some TCP/IP port where you can use log viewers. So for example, this log viewer and check for logs on or listen to log messages on some internet port. So you can also see logs from machines that are remote. So now I have started this log viewer and we can run this problem here again. So run this calibration again. And hopefully now he will also send the log messages to this TCP/IP port, so to this log viewer. So let's have a look. So you see there are now log messages coming in, and you also see that there are log messages coming in from the Leben-Berg-Marquardt algorithm. And you can step here through and you see here all the iterations of your Leben-Berg-Marquardt algorithm. So this is iteration 3 with the lambda value, the current root mean square error, and all the parameters. And you see, by the way, our calibration has 48 parameters. Yeah, so starting in 0 here, 48 parameters. So a lot of parameters. And after 8 iterations, he has found the minimum. So that was a small remark on logging. And I like to conclude maybe also very shortly now with running this stuff in the cloud. So I'm using here Amazon Cloud as an example. Yeah, so all the clouds, Google, Microsoft, or whatever you like, yeah, Oracle, are similar. I'm just using Amazon because it's maybe easier. I mean, all the others are the same. Okay, so first step is you have to log in here into the Amazon Web Service Console. So let me do that. Okay, something in the way here. So sign in to console. So you can do this, I believe, with your normal Amazon account. Of course, this costs money if you do calculations. I'm using here Elastic Computing Cloud, EC2, so as a service. And now I can launch an instance, so I can launch a computer in the cloud and use that computer. Okay, so that's actually nice. If you have to do some calculations and you do not have such a powerful computer, you can launch here one and rent one. So I'm launching an instance. First step is you have to decide which operating system you use. So step one, choose here a machine image. If we would like to do GPU computing, you should use an operating system that already has this installed. So these images are operating systems plus additional tools. Yeah, and you find many different ones here, like Red Hat Linux, yeah, or an Ubuntu. And if you, for example, enter here GPU or CUDA, you find different images here that already come with some stuff pre-installed. So maybe I choose this. Yeah, we don't do GPU today, but that's just you can select these images. Now you can select the machine. Yeah. So second step here is choose an instant type. So that's the machine type you would like to use. You can go here to this page, learn more, and have a look at all those machine types, for example, general purpose machines or compute optimized machines. And you see there are different types here with different CPUs. So if you have a program that is highly parallelized, you can use here 64 CPUs and 180 gigabytes of memory. Of course, these have different prices. Yeah. So you can choose one of these families here. If you would like to do something with a graphic card, with a GPU, maybe you have to choose the corresponding machine here. So that is here with accelerated computing. Yeah, for example, G3 has an NVIDIA Tesla GPU. Yeah, so if you choose that one, you will have a GPU. So you can use some instant type. And that's it. Yeah. So then you just launch it. And to log in into this machine, you need a password or and a user. Well, that actually doesn't work. So what we do is we have a set of public and secret keys, which Amazon uses and which where I know I have the private key to log in into the machine. And here you can select which private key you would like to use to log in. So here I'm using the key that is called FinMart. You will see that in a second on the console. And now he's launching this machine. So these were two old ones. I can start them again, but this here is the one which we have just launched. You can click on this and you see here the address of the machine. So I copy this address and now we can connect to this machine. So how do we connect to this machine? I use SSH to connect to this machine, secure shell. Yeah. So when I use this command, I have to specify the user. The username of that is used here is part of the machine image and may be different. So I used an Ubuntu operating system. Here the username is Ubuntu. And then I have to specify my password, but my password is just my secret key. So I'm passing here this file, which I have just specified. So this here is my identity file. So this is my password to log in. And here, of course, that is the IP number, which I have just copied. Yeah, so that one will also change and you have to look it up and it's here. So this here is now the IP number. So let's log in to this machine. There is the option Y, which allows me to route the display of graphic output from the remote machine to my machine. There is the option L for the user. The option I for the password in terms of this secret key file, and of course the IP number. And now I'm logging in to this remote machine. Okay, so you see here EC2, yeah, Amazon. This is the deep learning image because it has some GPU stuff here, CUDA 10, CUDA 11, and whatever. I'm now on the machine. And now I can do all the stuff that we did locally. Yeah, I can do it remotely. Of course, it may happen that your machine doesn't have stuff installed. Well, maybe you can find a better image which already has the stuff installed. For example, here, if we don't have Maven installed and we don't have Java 11 installed, then we have to issue some commands which will install this. And then we can run our experiment again. So maybe I like to do this now on this machine here. So let's check if we have Maven installed. So Maven is not installed, but he tells me you can install it with this command. Okay, if that happens, the machine is currently installing some other stuff and we have to wait a little bit. This depends a little bit on the image you use, and maybe sometimes it's good if you find an image where already stuff is pre-installed. So let's check what he's doing. He's doing some stuff. So maybe try again. Okay, so now I can install Maven. Yeah, so now he is installing Maven on this machine. My machine is now here. This machine is in the cloud. Yeah, you see here it's the Ubuntu from Amazon. So let's check Java. Okay, it's Java 8. I would like to have Java 11. So I can install Java 11 here. OpenJDK 11. OpenJDK 11 headless. So now I'm installing Java 11. So now that Java is installed, I create a directory Git where I check out my projects. And now we can just use Git as a tool to download stuff. So I download my experiments. Okay, so he will just check this project out. He will just download the project. And also if I do updates to the project, I can just pull it. And now I can run the command, which we have run here locally. For example, that one or that one. I can run this command on the remote machine. So let's copy this and run it now on the remote machine. So this is the experiment that created experiments on the numerical error of the zero covert bond. And you see now Maven is taking care of downloading all the dependencies. Yeah, you see he is downloading there from the internet a lot of stuff, like all the libraries we use, the Commons math library and so on. And that's just taking a short time. But he is also only doing it once. And then he runs our program on the remote machine. You see that I get also the graphical output here. And you see that the graphical output looks a little bit different. Yeah, so from the font here, because now I'm using an X server to have the remote graphic transferred here to this machine. This is because I have this argument Y. This argument Y here on the SSH, yeah, this argument Y is redirecting the display to your computer. So I could also launch Eclipse or something on this computer and have the display on my computer. So I'm getting all these nice experiments here now running in the Amazon cloud, in the cloud. Okay. And I will use this if I do GPU computing. For example, here my machine has a graphic card from AMD. And if I would like to do something with CUDA, I don't have an NVIDIA card here. I can just rent a machine that has an NVIDIA card, and I too can do the GPU computing on this machine. So that's also very useful for that. So we can also run the other program, and introduction into GPU computing will be a different session. Yeah, that's it. Yeah, of course, here this stuff costs a little bit of money, but it's not so expensive. And they also offer some free machines, so you can experiment a little bit and you don't have to pay anything. Yeah, that's a nice thing. You can now stop this instant, so I can just stop the machine. So if we go here again to the console, okay, I have a small out of memory error here. So you see here, I'm still on the remote machine. Yeah. So now I stop the instance. So now he's stopping. So, you see here, he is closing the connection. So now the machine is down again. You can keep this image here on your storage. This also costs a little bit of money to keep this storage. But I can now start the machine again. So in that case, you get here below a new IP address, a new IP that is different from the one. Huh? okay, we have to wait a little bit. And but the advantage is if you now log in into this machine here, so if you now copy the address and if you log in into this machine, so now it's a different address, then all the stuff you have installed previously is still there. Okay, so if I now log in into this machine, you see it's a different IP address. I can go to the Git repository and there is my experiments. And for example, the Java 11 is also installed. Yeah? So you can keep this set up and use it at a later time. Yeah, that was it for today. Thank you.